going to record the Theology of Rock podcast protest edition. And just so you all know, if you weren't here last time but or have heard it, in that same week, there were two different podcasts, Barry, you and then Rob Bell.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you want to know which one spent about 48 hours in the top 10 in religion podcasts?
Taylor Wims?
Correct. Because love is a losing game.
That's right.
You like that reference?
That's right. Well done. See?
See?
But in a podcast, the losing game is a winning one.
Ah.
Yeah. All right.
Yes.
Tripp, are you going to do a big intro?
That hurt my hands. Are we? Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. TNT? Hold on. Right. Yeah. We.
An official start.
Oh, yeah. Hold on.
So when I'm editing, I know where.
If they don't see what's happening right now, currently they're about 400 fists pounding. The smell of testosterone is going across the room.
Stop stealing me, Lich.
All right, here we are, Barry.
Hello, Trip.
Theology of Rock Part Trace. And this time, not only do we have to be quick, but we got to get protesty.
All right,
you may or may not know this since you're not, you know, a real American. I don't hear an American voice coming out of your mouth. But
doesn't that make me an American, though?
No.
Like the immigrant thing, you know, that whole deal?
That was like a...
I should be speaking Lakota Sioux, then.
No, you forget how our myth of origin works.
Yeah.
There was nothing, and then there was democracy, freedom, and liberty, followed by it being threatened by the Muslim Marxist, who's currently...
I actually thought that there was Native Americans doing quite well. Then the
wrong.
Then the Puritans that we expelled... Because they're a little too uptight.
The Puritans haunt me every night.
Then a glossy veneer of Manifest Destiny, which is now a Band Gap t-shirt.
Yeah, I saw that.
And a socialist in the White House.
Oh.
Okay, that was the quick version.
Lord, hear our
you
prayer.
You have the basic high points.
But exactly. Yeah. The protest tradition start early. And most people don't, they're Sunday school teachers and they're elementary school teachers miss those two verses of Woody Guthrie's This Land Is Your Land, where on the other side of the no trespassing sign, it said nothing. So he says, well, I guess this land was made for you and me. Then he has this interesting one about the unemployment lines. And it's ironic at that point.
I didn't sing that one in Sunday school.
You didn't?
No.
Well, then
we sang all the other verses.
You missed out. Woody, when he was talking about the song, said that he was sick of hearing God Bless America in 1940 during the Depression. So maybe you could say a little bit about where this kind of music, folk and rock and this kind of roots music in America began to be a place of protest in our culture.
Well, I mean, I think we have to start by saying that it isn't just... a form of protest in American culture, that the roots of protest music go back almost, I would imagine, to the beginnings of music, in that music, and particularly folk music, which is the music of the people, was a primary lens through which contrary positions, subversive views, counter-political ideas were propagated in a kind of sing-along, folksy way. And there's this tradition that's emerged that sometimes what can't be said directly can be best said when set to music. And of course, there's a rich tradition of that. And protest music is always situational. It always happens because of something. So Woody Guthrie, because of the Depression, he doesn't want to hear that song anymore. So the counter song is a different song, a song about this land is your land. So the protest song has this amazing place in the annals of popular music, and it crops up again and again and again in different forms. And one of the big discussions that's been going around of late, and I don't know, there's a couple of interesting books about music have been around lately. One is David Byrne's book, How Music Works, but the other one is Neil Young's autobiography about peace. And you know, Neil Young seems to think there's no protest music today because he thinks that people have sort of forgotten the big ideas of the 60s. But the context is different, so the protest is different. So you have Radiohead, you've got Rage Against the Machine, you've got this whole movement of people going into different areas, and maybe they don't cover the singular idea, but we don't live in a singular society anymore. Mm. And I'll get close to the microphone. Mm. I was sitting back as a protest.
Yes, but it is. Oh, there you go. The man in black.
Well, you wonder why I always dress in black.
I do. Could you tell me?
Why you never see bright colors on my back?
I've never seen bright colors.
Because he's from L.A.
Why does my appearance seem to have a somber tone? Well, there's a reason for the things that I have on. I wear the black for the poor and the beaten down.
So there you go.
Living in the hopeless, hungry side of town.
I mean, as we talked about last month, there are two men in black in pop music. Roy Orbison, who sings of the brokenhearted, and Johnny Cash, who sings of the other brokenhearted, those broken by poor, the dispossessed, and that country music protest tradition. And, I mean, Johnny Cash lived his theology, and it was expressed from the way he dressed to what he sang about, even though his life was a lot of times very, very separated from the people that he sang about. He managed to just invoke always in everything that he said this idea. And I think I would argue that much of the music of Johnny Cash was a protest against the way things were.
Maybe you should say a little bit just about the idea of putting out a live album from a prison. I mean, now people just assume that he ran a Kickstarter campaign.
Sure.
And was there, and it was going to be really awesome and trendy. But there was protests from the record label. There was even protests.
Well, it was pop music, even in the early days, was a very genteel affair. And even though pop music itself was regarded as the music of youth and of youthful rebellion and stuff like that, that rebellion was okay if it was contained within the horizon of, you know, rebelling against the surf instructor or the school teacher and stuff like that. But when Johnny Cash wanted to take his music into the prison to entertain prisoners, those who've been, you know, judged guilty by society and actually identify with them in that situation, it's hard to imagine now because so much of that stuff goes on. But Johnny Cash put his career on the line to go into a prison and entertain a bunch of criminals precisely because of this idea that it was really fueled by his strong belief that the gospel was about identifying with those in prison and the poor and the marginalized and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. And one of the things that Woody and Johnny both have in common is that, at least in their time, there was very strong reaction against them, but there was also this kind of okay, so my family, my mom's from Okemah, where Woody Guthrie's from.
Sure.
And Okemah, Oklahoma, didn't claim him for a long time, but a good third of the city loved him forever.
Yeah.
And then they reclaimed him later when I guess he got a little less rambunctious or they edited out the right verses. And
sure.
And Johnny Cash has had this kind of being reclaimed by people for nostalgia's sake and sure. remembering the song.
Domesticated as well.
Yeah, so maybe you should say a little bit about the way that happened.
So This Land Is Your Land becomes the kind of anti or other American national anthem, but its power is dissipated by what's is essentially omitted from it. You know, so the emphasis becomes this land, and it becomes this communal our land. But it was voiced from those who were dispossessed, and one of the dynamics I think in popular music that becomes troubling is the enshrining, you know, the icon movement that makes saints out of people and strips away why they would have been saints in the first place, which is always because they had an edge.
Uh-huh. You know what Luckily, I mean? We never did that with Jesus.
No.
So,
nor anybody else.
What happened in the time where you had these kind of tunes from the underside to a time where on the radio was this rather rambunctious song saying that, that things really are changing. What was going on where protest music shifted from just giving voice to the economic underside to this kind of change that Dylan grabbed?
The change is a seismic cultural shift that affected all stratas of society and all socioeconomic dynamics. And Dylan was at the heart of two things. One, he was embedded in the music, the folk music culture. So he was aware of the role of the protest song, you know, because it's an integral part of the folk music genre. But he was also embedded in the emerging youth culture that was redefining how it saw itself in the world. And so Dylan acknowledges what is, not just what he wants or hopes, but how reality is shifting and changing. Of course, the interesting thing about this song for me, and maybe the most not the most interesting thing, but one of the most interesting things about this is that this song and Blowing in the Wind were integral songs for the civil rights movement, but they also provoked counter songs from within the civil rights movement. So Sam Cooke wrote A Change Is Gonna Come because he heard Bob Dylan echoing what his own people were trying to say. So these songs become the fodder, the grist, if you like, for other songs to emerge. So Dylan he was called, much to his own dislike, I think, the voice of a generation and the prophet of a generation. But really, to some degree, what protest songs are statements of reality. This is what is. And they protest because they don't deal with the ideal. They deal with reality in its brutal form.
Mm-hmm. So what happened between Bruce Springsteen, Woodstock, the optimism of the late 60s and early 70s, and the time that Don Henley patronizes everybody? Because until I started reading a book on protest music, I did not know that All She Wants to Do Is Dance is actually mocking Reaganites for not knowing that they're funding wars in Latin America, that the economic disparity between the rich and poor in our own country is going under, that child poverty has tripled. And, you know, Don Henley says this, and he's like, she wants to do is dance.
You can say what you like about Don Henley and the Eagles. You can like or dislike the music. You may not get a peaceful, easy feeling from listening to them. But Don Henley is actually an incredibly insightful social commentator. And a lot of the lyrics that Henley brings to the table have a certain social bite to them. He's got that kind of ability, a cynical eye. So the protest, it's a bit like, I'd put like Don Henley's thing over there with like Goodnight Irene. So Goodnight Irene is a Lead Belly song. You know, Goodnight Irene, Irene, goodnight, Irene, Irene. You know, on the one level, it's a sort of love song. But it was written by an African-American prisoner, social outcast. And it took on this very early shape of being a sort of cynical form of cultural critique in some ways. And I think Henley fits right in there. But of course, what happened is the loss of innocence, which is another thing that Henley sings about. So when Dylan's singing The Times That Are Changing, there's hope. By the time you get to Don Henley in the 80s, there's cynicism. Cynicism's replaced hope because those ideals didn't become reality. What happened was the 70s, oil embargoes, economic collapse, mm-hmm. You know, and then the 80s sort of embrace of a kind of new consumer capitalist ethic that put this bite on society and drove us more and more towards, I think, a narcissistic consumerist element that made it very easy to look at things very cynically, like who cares? I mean, and I think it's where we're at now, you know. So here we are. I think we're still at war. We were at war the last time we did one of these podcasts. We're still at war now, but But we're not affected by it. We just go on with business as usual, you know. And in fact, we're encouraged to shop to keep the economy going. We don't feel this anymore. So you see these protest things pop up.
So when you said in the last podcast, "Why Music Matters," yep, was the title of a class, and now you're not sure it did. How much of the role music plays in culture has impacted its the possibilities it has to protest, or what is it that has not only moved music down the wire and that there's more and more voices, more and more tunes, and all that kind of thing, but that you can have a number one song like this one and have no clue that the persons that were listening to it, buying it, and singing it on the top 40 radio stations were falling in the trap. It's kind of like Weezer's Beverly Hills song.
Sure.
That if you wanted to listen to it while in Beverly Hills, then yeah, you didn't pay attention to the song itself.
Well, I mean, that's the dance with pop music, is that it's not didactic. You have to pay attention if you want to know what's going on. And I think that the reason I sort of transition from this idea of music mattering to not being so sure anymore wasn't just because of the proliferation or the amount of music. It's the other forms by which you can more perhaps effectively, I don't know if it's effectively, but you know, there was no social media defining a generation when Dylan was singing The Times are Changing. Music was a singular vehicle for the expression of ideas. It's not the only pathway now. I think it still has a resonance, but I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm. And what I find actually interesting in that time period, that's also where you get the appropriation of these kind of protest songs like Woody Guthrie and such for very nationalistic purposes, when he was kind of critiquing the kind of dominant vision of the nation in that song. And then when it comes to Bruce Springsteen and his American Skin 41 Shots, there's a funny story that, where did I write it down? There it is. So in this song, he's actually critiquing the way that America and its political system, and Reagan in particular, used veterans and failed to care for them when they came back. And Reagan misinterpreted it and then started using it in his presidential campaign. Maybe you could say a bit of that, because there is this sense in which, right, art, the person that experiences it and receives it is part of the meaning making. And then there's this sense that the protester goes, no, you don't get to do that with this song. I was shaking my finger at you.
Well, yeah, and this is where protest music becomes slightly separated from other forms, I think, of pop music. In that there is a different lyrical content in a protest song than a love song. A love song, the multiple interpretations are okay. But when you sort of move into the realm of a protest song and you reinterpret the intention of the artist, chances are you're likely to hear from them. And of course, you hear these songs, and protest songs are, by default, anthemic. They're anthems. So, and of course, when you hear your own country named and it's an anthemic song, you assume the positive aspect of it, and it feels like you're identifying. But so, as so often happens, it's that thing where we look before we we don't look before we leap, and they don't actually pay attention to know what's going on, and so they appropriate a song. I mean, it happened in the last go-around, or in the present go-around, with people appropriating songs, and it's become the default political move now. As you find some song that the kids are singing, and you make it yours, you know, and that becomes your party anthem. But I don't know who they need to have a pop music advisor on every political campaign, because there's always some idiot that hears a song and goes, oh, it's about America. We're about America. Let's go, you know? And
yeah. Well, did you know that Paul Ryan's favorite band was Rage Against the Machine? And now, this actually is where protest music,
it's music
took on a
to
new
wash
genre.
Soup kitchen plates by.
So Rage Against the Machine doesn't have a genre other than protest. And this song was one of the first music videos, the only music video at least I know of, that Michael Moore directed.
Yeah.
And there have been more plays of this video on social media since Occupy than when it was made in the late 90s, because Rage Against the Machine and Sleep Now in the Fire is playing over a burning Wall Street, flashing to images of poverty in the United States.
Because Rage Against the Machine, I think, I'm going to say this, are a prophetic band. And it took, like Dylan, a decade for people to catch up with what they were saying. They were ahead of their time, because the politicizing of the fact that they made music to underscore their political ideology took a while to sink in, and it precipitated, I think, a moment, and that moment finally arrived unexpectedly. And when people looked around for what could characterize that, there it was. There they were, waiting for it, and it found its point. What are you pointing at? Oh, you want me close to the mic?
Yeah.
Sorry.
So maybe you could say a bit about that, because I guess in the 7 or 8 years before Rage Against the Machine and kind of after the protest songs that went kind of counter Reagan Revolution, you saw the proliferation of kind of individual topic protest songs, right? Like Ani DeFranco or sure. These kind of things where they're, and you mentioned Coldplay and the ecology or these kind of things where there's a particular...
I didn't mention Coldplay.
Well, I thought you mentioned them.
Yeah, I thought you did earlier.
No.
Or last time.
Maybe, but only in mistake.
Well.
It was a slip of the tongue.
But so what...
To quote Motley Crue.
So culturally, how would you differentiate the kind of in the 90s up until people started to respond to a world after 9/11 and its consequences, this kind of protest on issues, and then all of a sudden there's this multitude saying, let's do the protest for 99.
Here's the positive side to me of social media, is that I think it reflects a desire. And we can get into arguments and debates about the whole community component and whether it diminishes or supports community, all those kind of things. But I think what I want to say is that the 90s hyper-individualism is giving way to a more socially mediated community dynamic that's re-engaging with social issues on a larger scale. For the 90s, really, politics and economics were... It's not that they weren't important, but there wasn't much happening. But since, in the last few years with the bank crisis, the housing crisis, the new economic realities that are affecting people who listen to pop music and stuff, I think that what you see in the reappropriation of this 90s stuff that at the time, I mean, Rage Against the Machine were essentially a cult band. But I don't think they were very understood by the mainstream. And it took the Occupy movement to give clarity to what Rage Against the Machine were all about. That and touring with Springsteen, I think, or at least Tom Morello playing with Springsteen. But there's the other thing, and you can look through these songs, whether it's Woody Guthrie or Johnny Cash or Dylan's Times They Are Changing. They're like things that bob in the water and they sink for a while and they're lost in the ocean of musical noise, and then at the right moment they just pop up to the surface and you see them again and you hear them again and they become new songs. So even though I think they're always situational and always contextual, they get recontextualized because the moment asks for it.
So one of the questions I've had is the recent transformation of what was kind of the underclass country music used to be the kind of the protest area for white people in the United States. And now country music has transformed to be quite the opposite. And even these early protest of protest songs, like Merle Haggard, is the worst song he ever wrote, which is for some reason the most popular one. So Just listen, it got worse. This is a live version. He changed the words and made it worse.
All we ever dropped our BVD. We don't know no hippies, queers, or commies. Cause we like living right and being free. And I'm proud to be.
So and it gets every verse, what used to be kind of the normative, like the words, and they were, you know, kind of more jokey, oh, we don't have long hair and sure. Go to Woodstock, became these, like, politically correct words to trigger these words that Rush Limbaugh's made evil, like, you know, liberal, communitarian, all these kinds of things sure. that used to get used by both parties, presidents and such. And what is it that all of a sudden this folk country got turned from the place of protest to the indignation of the dominant?
Domestication. Just simply domestication. And the fear that comes with xenophobia. It's the counter to protest is the bemoaning, the disgruntled sense of entitlement that comes from being a part of the majority of the power, the power grid. This is my problem, to be honest, with country music, is that I appreciate its rootsiness and its American, the celebration of an American kind of living. My concern about it is that it's obsessed with deifying and reifying a particular way of being American that can be incredibly nationalistic and isolationist. And yeah, you've got to turn that off because I'll actually throw that thing off the thing. I got no time.
Toby.
I got no time for Toby.
Oh, my. Barry, is there any danger in, as an artist, using irony and sarcasm that your audience just isn't smart enough to grab it as it comes by because of the rate at which they're
consuming? If you're British, you can't write a song without it. there's always a danger. The yeah. danger is that what is intended as ironic and sarcastic yeah. is taken at face value because somebody, it's, you know, they affirm what they want to hear in it and they don't get the ironic yeah. part of it. And so the way music trades
yeah.
in it conceptually, it can be very difficult when someone intends irony. That might be Don Henley, really. I mean, Don Henley is
right, that's what it
the ironic tagline.
I'm
sure Toby Keith was being ironic.
Unfortunately, he wasn't. I got broken of. I have this affection for irony. I just big fan. But I got broken of it because no one was understanding the joke. So, like for instance, the fall of 2001. I'm a fly fisherman. I was living in the Northeast. I stop in this hunting fishing place, and they have these hilarious stickers you can put on your truck. That are terrorist hunting stickers, and for all of them, the license number is whatever, 9/11 is the end. I thought it was hilarious. I bought one. I put it on the window of my truck in a prominent place. My friends wouldn't even get in the truck with me. No one, they ended up putting a duct tape over it, getting in, taking it off. No one thought that was funny. I thought it was hilarious until I realized other people were buying it, putting it in their cars, but seriously.
Sure.
So when it comes to music, an artist puts something out, they're not in control of that. They don't get that instant feedback to say, actually, I was doing something quite different with that.
Yeah, and to some degree, there's not much you can do about that. I mean, unless you have a certain amount of clout, so you're somebody like Dylan or Springsteen, you can say, no, I don't want you to sing that song, and people mm-hmm. can hear you. But you know, when you put something out into the public domain, you lose control of it. Mm-hmm. And there's not always a recourse for that.
Yeah.
One person that tweeted in said, Barry, how do you and all your AC/DC friends feel about how popular their songs are with paratroopers jumping out? And why is it that these songs that are basically just about rock and roll and a good time kind of have that place?
Obviously because paratroopers have big balls.
Well played, sir.
For those of you that don't know, that's an AC/DC song. Anyway, there is this idea, and it's actually a troubling one. And I can't speak for speak for AC/DC or anybody else, but I know that there's this this training mechanism where you amp people up with hard rock music, and kind of it's almost like a reverse meditative thing. You build them up into a bit of a frenzy, and the adrenaline rush takes them over the edge. I find it a bit worrying, really. I also worry about it in the Iron Man movies, but I'm not getting royalties, so.
All right. Well, the last one in this, it was hard to decide. Like, where protest music hit the streets and early rap music, then it turned into something different, and now there's a very concerted effort in rap music to bring the protest back. And Lupe, an LAite, the new album has tons of LA stuff in it. Now I can't pledge allegiance to your flag, cause I can't find no reconciliation
with your past, when there was nothing equal for my people in your mind. Yeah. You forced us in the ghetto, and then you took our dads. The belly of the beast, these streets are demons' abs. I'm telling you that set up in them sit-ups is so sad. The system is
so slapped. To set this up, I get sent, dude, have you heard the new Lupe album? By a 14-year-old at church. And when I get, like, I'm so pumped about this album, that's when I'll buy things that aren't between 1994 and 1998.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it's just STP Counting Crows Pearl.
Get over the Counting Crows, mate.
If you get a whole episode on Prince, then Adam Durst.
I'll get you over Counting Crows.
All right. Yeah. So, but here's what's funny. Like, so then I'm like, all right, I'll get it. So I download it. Yeah. I start listening to it, and I'm like, oh, this is like way better than, you know, I'm in a gang, I do drugs, I like loose women, blah, 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 or whatever. Because if I want to listen to that, I would rather go with Led Zeppelin. So you know, I'm sitting there thinking to myself, do they have a clue what it was that what they were listening to, and I didn't know how to talk? And then I found this website where it's like you scroll over the words, Lupe organized it, and has news links to the entire album, which he calls the Great American Rap Album. So I'm interested in, maybe you can say where protest music came in, maybe the different flavor it gets as not the privileged culture of white people in the United States that post 9/11 and post the kind of the growth of really like the new Jim Crow when it goes to inner cities related to cycles of poverty, drugs, and the kind of prison system.
Well, you know, I'm gonna say, not even in defense of it, but gangsta rap is protest music.
Say more.
It's the music of the powerless who seek to empower themselves by self-destruction and self-negation. I mean, Lupe Fiasco's song is called "Strange Fruition," so the homage is Billie Holiday's "Strange Fruit," and the strange fruit are the lynchings in the South. You know that iconic image of the guy hanging from the tree and everybody out, you know, on a Saturday night just kind of checking it all out, like, isn't this great, you know, some guy hanging from a tree. So, you know, almost 50, 60, 70 years later, you've got different fruit. It's not necessarily people being lynched, but it's people being equally marginalized, overlooked, dispossessed, not counted upon, not heard, not given voice. And still, in spite of that song and that moment and the apparent awareness of the need for change, the strange fruition of that moment is that it's not been dealt with. And so I find in a lot of hip-hop, a music that I'm not big on the whole gun gangster thing, as you can probably tell.
But look thugtastic.
I know, but I understand I don't understand, but I can intellectually grasp why this move to power, you know, whether it's through misogyny, through the hypersexualizing of women, whether it's through acting tough, through wealth, you know, so spinners on your Toyota. I mean, the ways in which we try and achieve the power models of the society around us because we can't achieve them in reality. That, I think, is an interesting component.